when we started doing this, I think I've come to see it as separate from a stage Bharatanatyam and then the street Bharatanatyam.
Okay, so you're saying exactly we're a complete different center, right?
Yeah.
To use Derrida here, that we are different centers. And they're not in opposition, it's a difference, exactly. What do you think is
okay? Stage is a place. I don't know. Seems like a stage is inside an auditorium, which sometimes, and sometimes outside also. Like, stages are made when there's a function, there's a program, but these are not programs. So why would a stage be made?
I started my dance life with Bharatanatyam at the age of 5.
Yeah. I've been dancing since the past 15 years now.
4.5 years. 5 years.
15 years.
12 to 13 years.
More than a decade.
Anjanatyam. It's a blend of Kuchipudi and Bharatanatyam.
I come from a convent school, and Bharatanatyam was one of the only dance forms that was actually taught in school right from class. Two onwards.
Back in school, there were performances that I actually watched.
When I think of Bharatanatyam, I associate it with my hobby classes in naval defense colonies, which were mostly taught by the wives of officers themselves.
So seeing it in my school performances, in our college performances.
When I came to LSR and I watched these performances, as far as, you know, Independence Day and these culture performances that keep taking place around the year,
I had a better exposure here in college.
In college when they do the competition, that's all.
And sometimes some program on the TV.
Yeah, I've seen it in auditorium.
Yeah, I've watched a few performances.
Observing on stage performances.
I've seen it on stage of...
On stages?
My sister's a Bharatanatyam dancer. Okay. So I've seen her perform a number of times.
Betu kotsin, betu amar iccha tara beshi ar Bharatanatyam amar bhalo lage.
Bharatanatyam, I know not next to nothing about it. You know, except for having gone for arangetrams of friends and friends' children and something like that.
I have not actually done any dancing, and I have never really watched a lot of performances, but I have found the art form very beautiful.
So the only experience I have with Bharatanatyam is that I used to do Kathak wrong, and the teacher used to tell me, this is how you keep your legs, like feet, in Bharatanatyam. I used to open it like a view. She used to correct me like that.
And as any true Tambram in Chennai, I went to a very, very sort of conservative teacher, right, Mylapur Ganesham Pillai. And most of my learning was done during the vacation time, because he believed that we should spend the whole day with him to learn dance. You know, it wasn't just dance, it was a whole way of life that one had to learn. I had to eat with them and literally, you know, sort of spend the whole day with them, and for about 2 months in a stretch, or maybe a month at a stretch. It was, in a way, I would say, punishing. It wasn't seen as recreational. I had to live, breathe, eat Bharatanatyam. I mean, it was just that, and for me, it was seen more as sadhana.
Temple. That really is the auditorium. Shabari Mandapam. Okay, this is the auditorium.
Because it started out as a temple dance. So has that ever struck you, I mean, in your limited experience?
I never thought about that, okay. But it's very interesting to find that out.
Yeah, it was a temple dance. And, you know, in its revival in the 20th century, that's why it moved to the urban proscenium stage.
It wasn't meant to be on the stage to begin with.
Totally not. In fact, before that, it was Sadir, which was like a solo dance performed by Devadasis. Devadasis were actually courtesans devoted to temples.
They were supposed to be married to the deities, to the male deities, and they danced to please the gods. I really like this transcendental kind of spirit that that dance had. The temple courtyard was like a liminal space between the celestial world and the earthly plane. But during colonialism and in the decolonization process, because the Victorian values along with the 19th century Indian reformism, you know, they had these set moralities about how women have to behave, because mostly, you know, these were women who were performing.
Around the period that we studied during Home on the World, there was the women question and cultural, you know, like anti-colonial movement that came with, you know, fixing upon cultural practices. So there's Rukmini Devi, who made this, who opened Kalakshetra, who made this a dance form that primarily upper-class, middle-class women started learning and performing, as opposed to Devdasis, who were often lower caste.
That's a complete shift.
Total shift. In the Natyashastra, one of the main rasas is the erotic one, Shringara rasa, and she kind of mitigated that one, and it became very domesticated, you know, which is a surprising term. But of course, there are protests against that too. Very complicated history. So it's always been about spaces, which is why Bharatanatyam in the Wild actually makes sense as an extension, which is something we realized way later after doing some research.
You know, don't think of it as pure and then, you know, something totally experimental. The genre itself has a history. That's what we have learned in cultural studies, right? That you historicize art forms, and you realize that many of the classical art forms that we receive today or understand as perennial were actually sort of took the shape that they are in only in the last 100 years. So one has to think about you know, contextualizing, historicizing, and to some extent therefore demythologizing, because practitioners are very invested in, very often, insisting on the pure unbroken lineage, right? Traditionalists, because it gives you a certain kind of past, you know, it's special.
Okay, so yes, what do you think about what we are doing?
The very name? I actually clicked on it because it sounded so interesting. The very idea of, you know, taking it out of that heroic space, it's just very fascinating, because you pay for watching recitals, you sit in an auditorium for 2-3 hours, and then you read up on it, and then you get what actually happened on stage for people like me. But, you know, dancing anywhere and everywhere is pretty amazing, because you let go of a lot of things, yet you retain your form.
No, Bharatanatyam ji, erokom bhabe, mane erokom ki bolbo, location e, erokom je kono dress pore, erokom bhabe nacha jay, eta ekta shotti adbhut legechilo prothome amar. It's very exciting.
I have never seen classical, Indian classical dance happening in public spaces, in the roads or in the metro or something like that. So yeah, that is there. That stigma with the Indian classical dance that comes with a kind of a baggage to it, that you have to do it in a particular place of where you have to uphold the sanctity of the dance and you have to do it in a particular way. So I think you're doing something which is transgressive. Taking away Bharatanatyam from that position of sanctity into the open and telling people that it need not have this, you know, kind of this elitist allegiance to it. And
this is the first time seeing you dance without the formalities. And it's not just to practice for another performance.
Without those paraphernalia, it is just normal. You're in a normal getup. Yeah, it is less alienating.
I think the stage performance just adds a bit of, you know, artificial glamour and all to it. But I think the performances you do in the open is more, I don't know, more fascinating.
When you dance on stage, like, you have to dress up, you have to do the makeup, especially for me the headgear and the whatever you have to do, tying your hair and everything, it's very tedious as well as painful, and I think it affects my dance also, because with that heavy thing it's very difficult for me to dance.
So I think, yeah, it's an attempt to maybe make it more democratized. Yeah. I like it that way.
I remember seeing the first video in the park, yeah. I think. I'd just been talking to some people about how we needed to experiment a little with more traditional forms. So when I saw this, I was like, oh, wait a second, did I talk to any one of y'all? And I was like, okay, no, wait, this didn't happen.
I think it's meaningful because there's this wider perception of Bharatanatyam being this very traditional, rigid art form that can happen only, you know, in the AC halls of Steinert or in a temple with those, you know, silk costumes. But I've always seen it experimented with, and I don't see it as a rigid art form that you can't do anything with. So I find it irritating and sad when people call it a very traditional static art form. It's very dynamic.
I felt that the girls are trying to make this contemporary in a very interesting way.
Mm-hmm.
Not by necessarily wearing Western clothes, not by, you know, putting some other kind of music, not by fusion, which is how a lot of the dance, you know. So your, from what I could make out, your movements were all pure, but you were doing it in very, you know, different spaces. So I found that very interesting, that without compromising on the purity of your dance, you have still made it contemporary.
So I was very taken aback, in obviously a very good way. My first reaction was I loved the fact that there was no music at all. After that, that they were so simple.
You know, the synchronicity hit me. I really loved it, and I used to love it earlier, and I thought this is what was remarkable here. You know, and also the levels, you know, you sort of kept to different levels. One was a little higher, the other was a little lower, you know, the, or different angles. I found that very interesting.
And going out in streets, those crossroads, or
those are like the monotonous places where you're bringing a new, like a very high form of art.
You're adding, a portion of everyday human life to something that is like a very, how do I say it, like mythical, you know, like how Indian classical dance always has this aura of mystery. That is not in relation with everyday life.
The dance is no longer performance, you know.
It's like breathing.
It's mundane, you know, it's regular, it happens all around you, right? So the performance aspect of it, that you need to dress in a certain manner, there's a time allotted for it, you need to invoke, you know, only in the morning with the sunrise can you dance, and you know, all of that is just dismantled and all. Okay, so while, you know, we've had a conversation before about this, when I told you, I suggested that, you know, when you end your videos, you should not just
yeah, we took that into account.
Exactly. But, you know, when I think about it now, I like the way you just, you know, let it go, you know. It's not necessary that you have to complete your step. You know, that's the idea of dance. You just lose the rhythm sometimes. You know, when you're humming a tune, you just stop randomly because it's done. You know, you don't have to always have a beginning and an end.
Yeah, and there's no choreography.
There
and we
no
usually
choreography.
Don't do those pieces that... Usually it's just the technical aspects of it that we do.
Yeah.
And not just that, like every performance has a certain aura around it.
Yeah. Mm.
So in that moment when you see her slouching or finish, like after the illusion has ended.
Exactly.
Yeah. So I always like that myself.
She starts looking at the camera first and she starts walking
You
know, because she's just like, oh, I need to know how I look.
Yeah, exactly.
It's fun, you know.
But so I'm going to respond aesthetically as to how, to begin with, as I said, I was a bit taken aback. Because I, you know, I also cringed a little bit because I thought that this was a breaking of the pure form, you know. So I, you know, as you understand art forms, and if you see a painting in a gallery, it has a different impact from where if you just take it out of the frame and put it somewhere casually, say in a classroom or whatever. It has a different impact altogether. Mm-hmm. So the aura and the
glamour
that you have, you know, the what Bourdieu talks about, the sort of the frame of the painting. That being taken away, I had some problems with it initially. And I think the again, to talk about the aesthetic perception, the satisfaction that you get in the art form is also to do with the costume. There's no costume there. You have some gungru sometime. And I said that to myself that this was something that was really strange, unusual, wacky. I like wacky things. So the second part of my understanding of it began with appreciating its wackiness, its you know, its quirkiness. I saw it as also attempts to do something different from the usual representation on the stage. And the spectacle aspects were of course reduced here, since there isn't that costume, there isn't the kind of curtain aura of the whole thing of the audience sitting in a darkened space, etc. So you are in the midst of the people. There is that way in which art seems to be in some way reduced. But then it's also enhanced because art's taken to the streets, which it needs to be done. Because there is too little understanding that people like me, the lay persons, have of art, of these art forms. So I put myself in this kind of Philistine group as, you know, the North Indian who has no training, who is a Punjabi, who, you know, who only can eat butter chicken or whatever. No kind of understanding of these fine, you know, aesthetic forms.
I never really realized how fixed Bharatanatyam is in my head. It should be on the stage until you actually take it outside of the stage and put it somewhere else. It jolted me. It made
Since you are my daughter, I love it and I would like to support it also. But Bharatanatyam on its own has sanctity. So it should be in that form only, according to me.
There's a specific attire that you're always supposed to go on, even when you practice, as a practice costume. So you can't just turn up in pajamas and do it.
Stage performances come after rigorous rehearsals. And so the focus is on the choreography, on the piece, and bringing out perfection. Mm. After my stint with the dancer, what happens is a lot of times we're very rigid because there are choreographers who come in. There's a heavy involvement of gurus who are very conservative. So there's very little space to experiment. But what's new about Bharatanatyam in the Wild videos is that it's not so well rehearsed. It's very experimental and brave. We take very little time to think of what to do. And it's mostly very simple steps.
And they turn up there, oh, we have this much space.
Yeah.
What can we do with it?
Yeah. It. Uh-huh. But isn't that the beauty of
it?
When you train under a guru, you have to... the ghunguru thing, that you can't wear those with your shoes. So there's always a spiritual... There's something sacred about this
dance. But you've done that. Wear your guru with your shoes. I remember that time.
After
to walk around.
Maybe, yeah. But that was maybe the first time I had done that. You know? Even I was very particular about that. I just never thought of it, is basically. The point was that I didn't want to do chanchan all over the place. But people would have been properly offended if I had done that in front of a guru. You know?
Talking about your guru, what do you think she'd think of her not even the world?
I hope she never sees this. Ever. Seriously.
How would your
guru react to that? Not very well, as I'd imagine, because she takes dance very spiritually. Spiritually, not just spiritually, like kind of religiously.
Well, I do think she'd have a problem with the attire. I'm not sure if she would be offended by the road thing. I hadn't thought that people would be offended by where we were doing it, but apparently that happens. Cut to
yes! I was thinking about that. To our YouTube hater. It's legit.
She puts things in perspective, you know.
Mm-hmm, exactly.
Swati.